Welcome to New Mountaintop Everywhere. I am so excited to share today's broadcast with you. I believe God is going to bless you in a very special way. Be sure to hit that share button, that thumbs up button. It helps us to get spread out so others can find us in the crowd of algorithms on YouTube. Hey, make sure you're in the comments. I love to go back and read your comments as we fellowship virtually. There's no church anywhere like New Mountaintop. Get ready to be blessed by God's word today.
Your season.
It's your season.
Yes, it is.
It's your season.
Good morning, New Mountaintop family. Listen, we hope you enjoyed the great James Big Nine and our New Mountaintop, Voices of New Mountaintop Choir. Listen, coming up next, my brother, my friend is back with us on today as our special musical guest, J.J. Harrison. I'm praying we can get him live in our sanctuary sooner than later. They will be ministering their new single, Thankful. I encourage you to go to any streaming platform that's out there and you can find this song and download it. This song is about to bless you. I promise you. It's going to bless your socks off. Right before we get ready to receive the word, enjoy this next selection, Thankful. Be blessed.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Give him glory. Today, and with chaos around, I'll still choose to say, Lord, I thank you for every way you come on, say, Lord, you've
done so much for me.
Come on, tell him,
you've given me
everything I need. With chaos around, I'll still choose.
Lord, I thank you.
Come on, tell him for every way.
I'm thankful to you, Lord.
All you've done. thankful to you, Lord. Hallelujah. I'm thankful to you, Lord, for all you've done and all you'll ever do. Hallelujah. Yes, Lord, I'm thankful to you. Oh, I am thankful. Lift it up, say, oh. I am thankful. Oh, God, I'm thankful. Oh, I am thankful. Now come on and worship him all over. Come on, lift your voice. If you're thankful, come on and give them glory. God, I owe you glory. God, I owe you praise. Receive my worship. Receive the honor. Receive the glory. Receive the praise. Receive what I owe you. 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 I owe you the praise. I owe you the glory. I owe you the honor. I owe you adoration. I owe you the glory.
Good morning, New Mountaintop. Oh, good morning, New Mountaintop. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, and his love and his mercy endureth forever. Welcome to New Mountaintop, Sunday at the Top. I greet you, for those of you all who are coming in live stream, welcome to Sunday at the Top. Well, I hope you had a wonderful and blessed Thanksgiving Day. I hope you enjoyed family and friends, and I'm sure you enjoyed a good meal. As we prepare to move into Advent season, our Thanksgiving was a day that was set aside that we remember. We should be thankful each and every day. But Thanksgiving is a day set aside that we especially think about and meditate on how good the Lord has been to us. For he has been better to us than we have been to ourselves. But if we want to think about how life is going to be, you know, as we go into the new year, we begin to think about New Year's resolutions. We begin to think about our plans for the year. And so if we want to think about that this morning, I would like to share with you some thoughts from the Word of God. Now I'd like to thank Bishop Littman for giving me this opportunity to stand before you. I thank our Heavenly Father for life and strength and allowing me to be able to deliver a word from on high. Go with me now in prayer. Oh, precious Lord, Lord, we thank you for the gift of your word. As we think on these words in your word, Lord, open our hearts and our minds to hear you. And now, Lord, may the meditation of my mouth and may the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer, in the precious and majestic name of Jesus. Amen and amen. This morning, our scripture text is Galatians 6 and 7. Be not deceived. God is not mocked. For whatever a man sow, that will he also reap. Let me say that to you one more time, because it's just one verse, but it's a powerful verse. Be not deceived. God is not mocked. For whatever a man sow, that will he also reap. Well, the Apostle Paul wrote this letter to the Christians, And he reminded them of the principles and the benefits of sowing and reaping. Paul also started this letter off by warning them that God would not be deceived. In other words, don't be led astray by your own human reasoning, by leaning to your own understanding. Don't be led astray by leaning to someone else's understanding. Let's go back and talk about sowing and reaping. To reap is to gather up a crop. To sow is to plant the seeds of the crop with expectations for to have a harvest. Now, this morning, I'd like to just give you a topic of the garden of your life. As you can see, I brought my fruit basket with me because I want the garden of my life to look like this fruit in this basket. I want it to be vibrant. I want it to be joyful. I want it to be positive and healthy. Well, this morning, so as a man sows, so shall he reap. Let's be sure that we don't lean to our understanding about sowing and reaping, because we know sometimes we can put some things in there that God did not intend to be there. One of the things about sowing is that sometimes we can justify what we sow. We base on our actions on what others have done. If someone has offended me, if someone has done something that is unpleasant for me, sometimes I think that I can sow something. I can sow unkindness, or I can sow anger. But the Lord says, be careful what you sow, because you shall reap a harvest. Well, let's look at this. Let's first determine what harvest that you're expecting, because we reap what we sow. If you want to reap love and joy in your lives, then you must plant love and joy in your lives. If you want to be loved, you must be loving. If you want friends, you must be friendly. Please take note that people are drawn to you by the way they feel in your presence. This is a byproduct of what you sow. So let's look at that. If in my garden I want love, I want joy, I've got to be careful about what I'm sowing. So if I'm sowing through my words and through my actions and through my deeds, let's think about our words. We must speak to a person in the language of encouragement, in the language of lifting them up. Our words have power. Then we must be careful that we're not using words that condemn, or words that tear down, or words that disappoint. Whether you are a soft place to land, or whether you're always the place that puts people always between a rock and a hard place, if you want to sow love into your life, you must plant love. Now, we cannot sow seeds of anger and stress and expect to reap joy and peace. So let's look at this apple. I could not have sown a seed with cucumbers and expect to reap apples. Just like these oranges and these lemons, I've got to plant the seeds of the things that I expect. Whatever a man sow, so shall he reap. And be careful about what's already in your garden. Well, there was this woman, and she was a friend of a woman who was Christ-like. As a matter of fact, she was a pastor's wife. And she began this young lady by the name of Angela. And Angela was so overjoyed when she came to the Lord. She was so excited about her new friend. They had prayed together. They had read the Word of God together. But when she became a Christ follower, she thought that everything that she had planted in her garden was now going to come up like apples and oranges. But unfortunately, it is a law. It is a spiritual law. It is a universal law that whatever you sow, you're going to reap. And even if you've already sown some things that weren't so pleasant, you're going to reap that. But here's the difference. When she went to her friend, she said, well, I love the Lord now, and I'm a Christ follower. So all those things that I planted before I knew Christ, surely I won't have the consequences of those actions. Well, her friend had to say, my dear sweet sister, because you have sown some negative things may come up, but here is the difference. Because you are now a Christian, because now you follow the Lord, because you made the Lord your Lord and Savior, now the Lord tells you that no matter what happens in your life, He is with you. As Psalms 46 and 1 says, He is your strength and your refuge, a very present help in time of trouble. So even if there's some negative things coming up in your garden, God is with you. God will walk you through that. And so even when we have to deal with some things that are unpleasant, we have a Savior that has promised to always be there. We know His promises are always yea and amen. Well, let's look at what could possibly already be before we plant the garden. What's in the soil? We have to be mindful that we didn't let some things like fear and anger be in the soil in the garden of our lives. The Lord tells you that be anxious for nothing but prayer and supplications about all things, and be careful to always give Him thanksgiving. He did not give us the spirit of fear, but of love and a sound mind. Well, my sisters and brothers, in order for us to understand the benefits of reaping and sowing in relationships, sometimes our spouses, our children, our family, and our friends, we have to imagine what qualities we want to reap and then work backwards. In other words, we have to, if we want love and we want peace and we want joy, we have to then work backwards and think about how do we sow those things. Well, if you want love in your life, let's think about love languages. If I want to be more loving, I need to sow the language of those who that I love, those who that I'm in relationship with. If it's understanding words of affirmation, then I need to sow encouraging words. I need to sow words that uplift. We know the Lord is the lifter of our heads and the keepers of our soul. I need to mimic that. If giving acts of service is what I need to sow, in other words, for me to reap love, then I need to be kind. I need to be thoughtful. I need to think what would be helpful for that person. Whatever we want to reap, we have to sow. Amen, amen. In our children, sometimes we think that we can sow what we speak. But we're going to sow not only what we speak, but we're going to sow what we act, because we know our children are watching us. They're going to plant what they have seen. Sometimes we look at our children and we think, well, I don't know where that come from. Well, it came from something that you planted, because they came into our lives with a blank slate, and we were giving the honor and we were giving the gift to plant into their lives. Be careful what you speak. Be more careful about what you do. Well, there's a few things that you must give to others if you want to harvest success in your life. A major part of the process of receiving success and living the kind of life that you dream of is to give. Many people think in order to get the wonderful life that you have to take, but it is a universal truth that if you go down the true path of what you want to give, when you give, you get. When you sow, you reap. And these are some of the things that if you sow, you will reap a successful journey. One of the things is to sow respect. Oftentimes, we think we only give respect to those who we say have earned it, who have done some amazing thing, who have accomplished much. But we should sow respect in others just because they're a child of God, just because they're a brother and a sister of the Most High God. We should believe that if we sow respect, that others will raise up to that standard. People oftentimes will raise up to the level of expectation. What would happen in our world, in our families, in our companies, if we started respecting rather than making people earn it? I believe that we would see people that would give life up to respect that we what we give them. The other thing is being vulnerable. We're taught to be strong, and yes, we should be strong. But sometimes when we allow people to see our vulnerability, when we allow people to see that we don't always have it together, that we need help, and we look to the Lord for our help comes from on high. When others see that I can be vulnerable in your presence, then they'll open up. Your relationships will become deeper. We're all broken people inside. We all have secrets. We all have to let down the veil for others to see. When we do that, we draw people in. So when we're planting respect to others, when we're planting vulnerability for others, then we need to make sure that we're planting care of others. Most of all, people want to know that you care. When I plant the seeds of caring, when I plant the seeds of gentleness, when I plant the seeds of kindness, those are real signs of success about caring for others. Take the time to show that you care. Listen to them, empathize with them, love on them. Well, the next thing that I would give that you would like to plant in your garden is the gift of passion. There's nothing more than we need in this world right now is passion, and we need passionate folks. We live in a day and time where we're just kind of beat down by the everyday. But if you can share with others the passion that you have for the Lord, the passion that you have for life, the passion that you have for the gifts that He has given you, share your energy, inspire others, and you will find that the energy is giving back to you. Whatever you sow, you shall reap. Then give others the gift and the seed that you're planting of your experiences. Sometimes we think that whatever we've learned, we just have to keep it to ourselves. But if I have learned some lessons, one of the greatest things that I can do is share it with others so they can learn from my mistakes and they can learn from my successes. If I'm allowed to share with you, then you can learn. If there's a hole up ahead, I can explain to you there's a hole up ahead in the road so you don't have to fall into the hole. I can share the gift of my experiences. Remember that we want to produce some good fruit in these gardens. We want to harvest something that we have dreamed of. So if I'm sharing respect, I'm sharing vulnerability, I'm sharing that I care, I'm planting this in my garden of life, I'm sharing passion and my experiences, then give others kindness and help. By nature, I believe that most people really want to help others. The Lord blesses us so that we can be a blessing to someone else. So often we think that our blessings are all about us. But if we really want to have a successful life, a joyful life, then we will always think of others and be a blessing. So give others your honesty, plant that. Give others your respect. Be careful to plant that. Give others that you care and your passion, your experiences, and your help. Well, the next point is we reap more than we sow. A farmer plants a seed because he expects it to multiply in the harvest. The principle works whether it's sowing something positive or sowing something negative. This applies also in our resources, our times, and our gifts. The Lord has already given us instructions on how to plant and to reap more than we planted. If we look even at our finances, if we say, one of the things that I want to harvest is a good financial life, a good healthy life, then the Lord has already given us instructions. He said, if you will give tithes to me, if you will give that 10%, then I will allow the other to bless you and give you all that you need and so much of what you want. The Lord has given us instructions. If we give, and then if we save, and then if we live, not only our resources in terms of finances, but with our talents. You were not blessed with all of your talents to keep them to yourself or to only those that you are in immediate contact with. You're blessed with those talents and resources to be a giver in the kingdom, to be a blessing to someone else. If you know how to cook well, bless someone else and teach them. Each one teach one. If you plant seeds of positivity, if you plant seeds that will reap something positive to someone else, while you're looking at someone else, God is taking care of you. He's blessing you. Right now, we're living in a time that is very anxiety-producing. We're in the middle of a pandemic. We're isolated. We were isolated for over 18 months. We weren't in our household of faith. We couldn't share Thanksgiving dinner like we just did yesterday. But in that time, God said, there's some things that I want you to do. I want you to do a little pruning in your garden. If you look back in your garden, let's get out the weed killer. Let's pull up the seeds of fear. Let's pull up the seeds of unforgiveness. Let's pull up the seeds of envy and jealousy, because that will cause weeds to grow in your garden. If you've ever looked at your yard or your flower garden, you know you have to do a lot of work for these flowers to bloom. But weeds grow fast and they multiply. So we have to be vigilant in our prayer that we are praying, Father God, do not allow me to operate in fear. Father God, do not allow me to operate and anger be my mode. Father, allow me to give the forgiveness and the grace that you have given me to others. Because whatever that we sow, I will reap. Whatever we sow, I will reap that in bigger portions. And a farmer understands that. So that is why the seed starts off small, but the harvest is big. Amen. Amen. We reap larger than we sow. And we reap later than we sow. So this requires patience and sacrifice. See, a farmer doesn't go out to the field and plant his seed on Monday and then show up on Tuesday expecting a harvest. He understands that every seed takes time a period of time to grow. You have to water it. The sun has to shine. It has to be fed, and eventually it will bloom. But right now we have to know, let us not become weary in well-doing, for in due season we will reap a harvest if we faint not. Now remember that. Let us not become weary of planting positive seeds. Let us not become weary of giving love. Let us not become weary of giving forgiveness to others like we have been so gracious. Let us not grow weary of doing good for others, for we shall reap a harvest, and we know that the harvest is going to be more plentiful than what we reap if we faint not. Because God doesn't want us to give out of compulsion. Now, let me be very clear. He doesn't want us to give or to plant for the sole purpose of reaping, but reaping is a benefit of what we sow. So we need to give from a place in our heart that is loving and that is kind. We need to plant into the life with others with great expectation. And then the last part of that phase, it says, if we faint not, if we complain not, if we're not doing it out of envy and jealousy, if we do good, don't grow weary of planting. Don't grow weary of cultivating. Don't grow weary of helping others. See, the Lord already gave us a clue, because he said, I gave you an example when he gave us the fruit of the Spirit. Look what's in the fruit of the Spirit. There's love and there's joy. There's peace and there's patience. There's kindness and there's goodness. There's faithfulness and there's gentleness. There's self-control. If we were able to take the seeds of the fruit of the Spirit and plant in the gardens of our life, then we could expect a harvest of everything that we dream about. Think about if you went to your garden on a daily basis and you planted love and you planted joy. So you look at life from the glasses half full rather than half empty. If you plant peace, think about what you would reap. When we plant peace and patience, we don't always have to be right. We don't always have to have it our way. When we plant peace and patience, we reap love, joy, peace, and patience. When we plant kindness and goodness, when we're kind and gentle to others, regardless of how they treat us, we reap kindness and goodness. I have a sister that always reminds me to never react based on how someone else treats you, but to react on how you want to be treated. So if you always plant and give kindness and goodness, if you always give peace and patience, you will reap peace, patience, kindness, and goodness. Well, the last thing that I would like to share with you is that keep in mind that we reap later than we sow. We reap whatever a man sow, he'll reap. Whatever he sows, he shall reap. We will reap it in bigger portions than we sow it, and we will reap it later than we sow. In other words, there's a season for all things. There's a season to plant, and there is a season to pluck up. And we have to water our garden with prayer and the word of God. So God is speaking into our lives so we know what season we're operating in. Father God, we ask you that you will give us directions on when we should be planting, how we should plant it, what season it is, Father God. So we thank you, Lord, for giving us the change of season, because we know seasons can change without notice. Please remember that if we faint not, if we do it with a cheerful heart, we can expect joy. If we do it with a kind and loving heart, we can expect love to come to us. We have to be careful that we are not watering the weeds in our life, that we're not watering envy, that we're not watering jealousy or resentment. No matter how we dress it up, we have to operate in honesty, because honesty produces trust, and trust produces love. And ultimately, we want to operate in love because God is of love. So I hope this morning you will think about what you want to harvest in your life, what you want your garden of life to look like. I will share with you, I want just a little more love in my garden. I want to operate every day in peace. I want to be treated with goodness and kindness. So because that's what I desire to reap, then I know that is what I must sow. Remember, it is a universal law. It is a spiritual law. God will not be mocked. Whatever a man soweth, so shall he reap. The Apostle Paul was very careful that there are benefits to reaping and sowing. There are benefits to being a blessing. And today, as we begin to close our this sermon and this message, I want you to just remember to ask God, what is it that I need to be sowing into my garden? What is it that I need to sow in someone else's garden? What else do I need to give to someone? You know, oftentimes one of the best things that when we're feeling a little down and when we're feeling a bit depressed is to pull yourself up and begin to think about someone else. While you get active and working in your garden, you know, playing in the dirt, planting something good, planting kindness or planting goodness, when you look around, everything that you planted, God has already given back to you. And before you know it, the anxiety is gone. The depression is gone. Whatever a man soweth, so shall he reap. Amen, amen. Well, I thank you for tuning in with us this morning to hear this word from God, to remember that we can have the dreams and the desires of our life. We can have a beautiful garden that we can operate in our lives if we are so careful to remember what we sow, we shall reap. Amen and amen and amen. Now, one of the greatest gifts, the ultimate gift, was when our Father gave us the gift of his Son. He gave us Jesus. He gave us Jesus, and then Jesus gave us the ultimate gift. He went to the cross for our sins. He went to the cross for our misgivings. He went to the cross for our misstep. And he was our Paschal Lamb. He took our punishment. The greatest gift of all, he sacrificed his life so that we could have life. And I would just offer to you today the greatest gift there has ever been, the gift of Jesus, the gift of salvation. When we say, Lord, I want you to be Lord and Savior of my life, the word says that if you believe it in your heart and confess it with your mouth, you shall be saved. So I offer you today the gift of Jesus. Now, I know you're not in the sanctuary with me. You're watching on live stream, or you're watching on your computer or on your phone. So just type in the chat, I want to accept the gift of Jesus. I want to accept the gift of salvation. The next call is, sometimes we have walked with the Lord. We have known the Lord. We have experienced the Lord. And then we stepped away, because God never leaves us. If there was some movement, it was always on our part. But the good news is, our Father is like the proverbial father looking down the road when his sons and daughter came home. He's standing there with wide stretched arms saying, my child, come home. So if you've stepped away from the Lord, he says you can always come home. So if you're in a position that you want to come back to the Lord, you want to walk with the Lord, you want to be in covenant with the Lord, that is our second call. It is okay. It is a wonderful thing. It is the greatest blessing to come home again and be at peace with the Lord. Type in the chat, I'm ready to come home. I'm ready to come back to the Lord. Well, if by chance you're in our area, you're in school, or you're just here for a short period of time, one of the best advice my mama ever said, she said, baby, don't ever be without a pastor and ever be without a church family. New Mountaintop is a good place to be. If you'd like to come under watch care, then I offer that to you. Type in, I want to join. I want to be in fellowship with New Mountaintop under watch care. The invitations are, I want to come closer to the Lord. I want salvation. I want to know that when I close my eyes on this side, when I'm open then on the other side, I'll be in the presence of the Lord for eternity. The second call was, I want to come back to the Lord. I want to come home. And the third call is watch care. Amen, amen. Well, as you prepare to go on with your week, I pray that you will have a wonderful week. I pray that you will remember what you sow in your garden, you shall also reap. And as we get ready to go, my final blessing is, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May his face shine upon you. May he be gracious to you. Go in peace with God and man. Amen, amen, and amen.
I trust that you enjoyed today's broadcast as much as we enjoy bringing it to you. It is our great privilege to serve you with God's word and to serve our community with the ministry of Jesus Christ. By all means, if you're looking for a church home, we'd love to have you to connect with us. It doesn't matter where you are. We're now open with our cyber congregation. Just send us an email. Let us know that you want to be a part of the New Mountaintop Church. I'd love to be your pastor wherever you are. The grace of God be with you. Be sure to tune in next week. God bless you.
I was young.